Good afternoon, everyone. We'd like to begin the vitreoretinal diseases 2 session. Very heartening to see such an audience in a vitreoretinal session, that also post lunch. So we'll start. Yeah, we'll start with the best paper from Delhi Ophthalmological Society session, and this is to Dr. Raghav Ravani. Over to Raghav, please.
Very good afternoon, everyone. At the outset, thank you for the opportunity to present our work on intraoperative OCT-assisted vitreoretinal surgery with fovea-sparing internal limiting membrane peeling for myopic traction maculopathy. We have no financial disclosures. The surgical technique has already been published in International Ophthalmology. So coming to the study concept, it will be divided into the relevance of the study, pathogenesis and the intervention in literature, and what is our approach. So coming to the the prevalence of pathological myopia varies geographically, with highest prevalence in Asian population. A study in Central India showed a rate of high myopia of about 0.53%. The prevalence of myopic traction maculopathy in highly myopes ranges from 9% to as high as 34%. And amongst those, approximately 69% shows progressive worsening of visual acuity. So coming to pathogenesis and the intervention based on the pathogenesis, basically there are two forces acting on it. The centripetal force, because of the adherence of vitreous cortex or vitrocytosis, presence of ERM, the rigid ILM, and traction of retinal vessels. The other is the centrifugal force, or due to posterior cephaloma. So in our study, we concentrated on this centripetal force. So this is the diagram showing, this is the OCT picture showing the retinoschisis and the adherent ILM, basically showing the centripetal forces in play. So coming to the interventions in literature, Hirakata et al. Had compared PPV with ILM peeling and without ILM peeling. And they had concluded that there is a better final best corrected visual acuity and reduction in recurrent rate if ILM has been peeled. Shimada et al. Had showed that if you spare the fovea, the chances of development of full thickness macular hole is decreased, and there is significantly better improvement in visual acuity. But in our experience, we had some difficulties, like surgical challenges we faced was to access the exact dimension of ILM sparing intraoperatively, and with use of intraoperative OCT, we had a better visualization and better idea of the cystic spaces which could be spared. So our aim was to study the anatomical and functional outcome of IOCT guided fovea sparing ILM peeling and to look for complications, if any, either intra-op or post-op. So inclusion criteria were patient with myopic traction maculopathy with best corrected visual acuity of less than 618, progressive worsening of visual acuity, and symptomatic patients. We excluded patients with pre-existing full thickness macular hole. We excluded patients with myopic macular hole retinal detachments, those with CNV or scars. So it was a consecutive case series of 9 eyes with 9 patients. The surgery was performed by a single surgeon using IOCT guided center sparing ILM peeling. Outcome parameters included both anatomical as well as functional outcomes. So this was the pro forma in which the patients were followed up. Coming to the surgical video, as you can see, with intraoperative OCT guided, we could see that there was a area of retinal thinning at the center, and there was a vitrocytosis. So after tricot assisted staining of the vitrocytosis, we gently peeled off the vitrocytosis rather than inducing the PVD with the cutter. We gently peeled it off, and then a BBG dye was used to stain the ILM. And then with intraoperative OCT guidance, we peeled the ILM, avoiding the area of cystic space and very thinned out retinas. At the end of the peeling, we could confirm that there was evident reduction in the traction during the ILM peeling. And that was one of our outcomes, that it also showed the endpoint of how much ILM could we peel. And here you can see there is a remnant ILM over the thinned out area. The fluid air exchange was done and gas tamponade was injected. Coming to the results, this is the pre and post-op OCT of the patient. So it Coming to the results, there was a significant decrease in central macular thickness from approximately 570 microns in the pre-op to 165 in the post-op, with improvement in best-corrected visual acuity. This is the graphical representation of the same. So to summarize, the average follow-up was 42.96 weeks in plus or minus 4.78. The resolution of macular retinoschisis was seen in all 9 patients. None of the patients showed development of full thickness macular hole intra-op or in the post-op. Mean time of resolution after surgery was 6.8 weeks plus or minus 1.07 weeks, and no complications were seen. So coming to the discussions, the area of retinal thinning at fovea were identified and surgical plan modified accordingly. It served to define an endpoint of the surgery with visualization of resolution of traction upon completion of vitrectomy and membrane peeling. And lastly, IOCT helped in assessment of and avoiding deroofing of cyst intraop. So to conclude, further studies with larger sample size are required to compare benefits of IOCT with and without ILM peeling, and also ILM peeling with and without IOCT guidance. And we report long-term outcomes of 9 such cases of an alliance of IOCT with vitreous surgery for myopic traction maculopathy, and vitrectomy with intraoperative OCT guided center sparing ILM peeling appears to have a favorable anatomical and functional outcomes and helps in circumventing complications and improves minuscule precision. These are the references, and thank you. We did not have control group for this because since we started previously before acquiring of IOCT, we had such patients. Can I get the screen again? Before we started this study, previously we had had such patients which were done without IOCT, and we had seen unfavorable outcomes. So when we started this, we did not go in with without IOCT group. Since we had better outcomes with this, we continued the same. Can I get this one, please?
In both the studies, was the surgeon same?
Yes, sir. Okay. So this was previous to the study when we started, when we saw that we had even had eccentric macular hole formation in areas of where we had cystic changes, and also the remnant traction. We were not able to relieve the traction entirely. So this was before the starting of surgery. So after that, we started with this, and so we had favorable outcomes. We continued with only one group.
So as your group is very small.
Yes.
So
this was at the time of when we submitted it. Right now, we have already done around 35 cases of the same, and like we are in the process of carrying it further.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you very much for the.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much for the lovely presentation. May I call Dr. Subhendu Boral for his work on submacular blood removal with RP choroid graft transplantation in submacular hematomas.
Good afternoon, everybody, respected chairperson, respected judges, my dear teachers, to our colleagues. Submacular blood removal with isolated autologous RP choroid patch graft transplantation in MUC submacular hematoma. None of us have any financing interest regarding this subject. We know the causes of subretinal hemorrhage is AMD, PCV, macroneurysms, or trauma. User prognosis of submacular hemorrhage is very poor due to barrier and toxic effect of the blood, as well as the shearing effect of the outer segment of the photoreceptor, and window of opportunity is within first 2 weeks of onset. And although the subretinal tissue plasminogen activator have some role, but for the large and elevated lesion for more than 1 month duration, vitrectomy along with subretinal blood removal without full thickness RP choroid graft transplant is an option. Our purpose of the study was to study the result of submacular blood removal with isolated autologous full thickness RP choroid graft transplantation in MUC submacular hematoma cases. It was a non-randomized prospective study done in 8 patients of massive submacular hematoma from April 2015 to March 2017. And the surgical techniques like in all 23 gauge vitrectomy done, followed by induction of retinal detachment like this with the help of 39 gauge or 41 gauge needle, and then creating localized retinal detachment in multiple areas, injecting BSS, and then creating temporal 6 to 7 clock hours retinectomy. But where the retina is already elevated, like in this case of hemorrhagic retinal detachment, we did cautery, temporal cautery, 6 to 7 clock hours, and did retinectomy to gain access to the subretinal space. Now we have to remove the blood, so we are removing the blood from the subretinal space. Sometimes this blood is very much thick, and sometimes fibrotic scars are there, so you have to remove the scars by neovascular membrane also. Sometimes this neovascular tissue is very much fleshy. With the help of this ILM forceps, we are removing this submacular neovascular tissue. You should take the, considering the its surrounding retinal attachment, then remove the subretinal tissue, and subretinal blood has to be removed, and if there is some kind of oozing from the feeder vessel, you have to do mild cautery. Now you have to inject PFCL subretinally to keep the retina apart, and do the you have to go for this RP choroid patch graft transplantation, taking the from the mid periphery relatively healthy looking RP areas, and taking the graft, considering its upside down manners, you have to reapposite under the PFCL, and you have to reapposite in the in the proposed site of fovea, and graft realignment done, then remove PFCL, and then inject PFCL again over the retina to reapposite, do free red exchange, and silicon and PFCL exchange done. Postoperatively, we did wide field fundus photograph opto, serial OCT, ICG, and multifocal ERG done. We included post AMD, post PCV, max submacular hematomas, excluding small and medium size submacular hematomas, as submacular hematomas of other origin. These are the clinical characteristics. Complications noted: recurrent retinal detachment in first case, and excessive subretinal scarring in fourth case. Like, mean age of presentation was 67 plus minus standard deviation in years, and mean post-op BCVA improved to 1.17 plus minus standard deviation in logMAR. Graft anemia decreased with follow-up, and in this case of submacular hematoma post-AMD, visual improvement seen from PLPR to logMAR 1 after 3 months, and you can see the submacular graft in C2 after 15 months of the follow-up. You can see gradual decrease in graft anemia. This is a case of CREST 2 submacular graft hematoma with post-AMD, visual improvement seen from PLPR to logMAR 1 after silicon removal. You can see the autologous RP graft, 9 months follow-up, and you can see the graft in C2, gradual decrease in graft and graft edema, and ultimately graft has been incorporated into RCC complex. And case 3, submacular hematoma AMD, where you can see visual improvement seen from hand movement to logMAR 0.78. Post AMD submacular hematoma, post SOR, you can see the submacular graft in C2, but there is excessive scarring. Another case, post AMD, post PCB hemorrhagic retinal detachment, visual improvement seen from PR inaccurate to logMAR 1.4. Another case of post PCB visual improvement seen from finger counting close to face to logMAR 1 after 6 weeks. Another case of hemorrhagic detachment, visual improvement seen from PR inaccurate stage to logMAR 1.4. Post AMD pharmacological hematoma, visual improvement seen from hand movement to logMAR 1.4. So, multifocal ERG showed some waveform in all, some waveform in comparison to the other eye. ICG showed revascularization of the translocated graft in 2 months. And this is the first study in India. And like other studies, our study also showed that a submacular blood removal with full thickness RP choroid graft is a viable option in cases of severe vision loss. Beneficial effect of submacular blood removal, it removes the barrier toxic effect of the submacular blood, as well as removal of the CNB tissue nearly completely removed the possibility of the rebleed. Beneficial effect of autologous RP choroid patch graft, it provides healthy RP cells, as well as the development of new feeder vessels on ICG indoors denotes that revascularization in ICG is anatomical viability, and post of visible ERG means it is functional improvement. So timely drainage is essential, and removal of the neovascular tissue is almost removed the possibility of the rebleed and decrease the cost burden of the intravitreal injection. Autologous full thickness RP choroid transplantation provide healthy RP cells, and ICG ERG proved both anatomic and functional improvement, as well as restoration of anatomical ambulatory vision with minimal risk of recurrence. So we can conclude, we can give something almost in no hope situation to some hope. Thank you.
Yes. Marked, mentioned as marked submacular hemorrhage. Is there any definition which you have included, like is it number of disc areas or based on the OCT submacular bleed thickness, no, or is there any criteria for that?
I have already mentioned it is more than 5 disc diameter in the fundus photography, in the like not in the OCT guide, it is a fundus photography, it is a heart mark, and it's mostly it is if it is much elevated lesion for these those cases. Initially, what happened before starting this study, we have injected subretinal TPA, vitrectomy and subretinal TPA. But in those cases where the already the there is huge hemorrhagic detachment or like huge elevated marked submacular hematoma, these cases usually fails. And usually when we are doing removing this subretinal blood, we are removing the subretinal neovascular tissue along with the scar tissue also.
So you have not tried vitrectomy displacement with TPA? Directly?
No, vitrectomy with submacular blood removal.
Yeah, no, you with haven't attempted any cases displacement.
Displacement I have tried previously, okay. But displacement it works in case of moderate condition, less than 5 disc diameter, small submacular hematoma, these cases doing very
is
well.
Is there a time cutoff for inclusion into this?
Yes, more than 1 month duration it is. I am much more included.
You mentioned it in your inclusion or exclusion criteria.
Yes, yes, it is those cases also.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Shubhendu. And with this, we'd like to call next speaker, Dr. Nishikant Borse.
Can I present my next paper also? I have two papers. If you
have no objection.
Any objection? Okay. So we'll go on the next work of Dr. Shubhendu for on new vitreoretinal challenges as eye with permanent keratoprosthesis.
Thank you, judges. My next topic is new vitreoretinal challenges in eyes with permanent keratoprosthesis, a 7-year study. None of us have any finance and interest regarding this subject. In eyes with keprotated eyes, several common obstacles like obtaining adequate surgical exposure, visualization, and hemostasis were noted for the last decades. And vitreoretinal complication, eyes with permanent kepro, one was noted at retroprosthetic membrane, RPM, retinal detachment, epiretinal membrane, vitreous opacity, debris, and endophthalmitis. Eyes with permanent kepro present unique challenges for posterior segment surgery. Managing vitreoretina through the small optical cylinder is also a real obstacle. So our purpose of the study is to assess the vitreoretinal complication outcomes of an intra and postoperative challenging factors after implantation of permanent kepro. It was a retrospective review of 102 cases of permanent kepro implanted by single anterior segment surgeon over 7 years time period from 2010 to 2016, and posterior segment complications were managed by a single surgeon at the same institution, where in all 23 cases vitrectomy done along with associated posteriors and siliconoil injection, 5000 centistroke injection done only in eyes with retinal detachment with or without PVR and persistent hypertonic cases. Challenging factors, intra and post-op factors identified were difficulty in visualization, difficulty in vitreous base excision, in recurrent intraoperative hypertony, intraoperative bleed, and post-operative chronic hypertony, that is hypertony persistent for more than 1 month duration. Total number of permanent Kepro 1 done in last 7 years, 102, out of which 86 were Boston Kepro, 16 were Oro Kepro. Out of 102 cases, 12 intervention done in 10 eyes who developed vitreoretinal problems after a mean period of 10.33 plus minus standard deviation in months. Mean post-op VCVA improved to 0.95 plus minus standard deviation in logMAR. This is the clinical table showing the clinical characteristic and challenging factors. Primary retinal detachment, recommendation retinal detachment with PVR noted in 2 cases of our case series. Hemorrhagic retinal detachment were noted in only 1 case, where we are after doing vitrectomy, we are stabilizing the posterior pole with the help of PFCL. Then removal of the subretinal blood was possible from the peripheral breaks, and then after completion of the vitrectomy and removal of the subretinal blood, we are doing a fluid exchange followed by laser and siliconoil injection. Post-vitrectomy retinal detachment seen in only 1 case. Persistent hypotony with choroidal detachment noted in 2 cases. Epiretinal membrane formation seen in only 1 case. And ERM post-op OCT showing the 3 months OCT showing their absence of ERM. After type 1 blue SST DRM removal has been done. And this is sterile vitreoretinitis with scleroidals with macular folds that is visible after the clearing all the vitreous debris. And you can see the radial choroidal folds, macular folds around the disc. Retroposterolytic membrane was noted in only one case. Severely vascularized RPM with we are doing partial membranectomy for this case. Severely vascularized RPM was noted with vitreous hemorrhage only one case. Endophthalmitis that was culture negative with vitreous abscess noted in one case, where we are clearing the all vitreous exudate through the Boston Capro, and ultimately this case visible. For silicone removal with reinjection done in only one case. Post-vascular RPM with vitreous hemorrhage noted, and in this case, final VCV again log mod 1. Post-op RPM with final VCV again log mod 1.4. Post-op hemorrhagic detachment and after silicone removal, vision gain to log mod 1. Post-op sterile endophthalmitis, vision gain log mod 1. But post-SOR, we injected silicone oil to prevent hypotony, vision improvement ultimately log mod 1. This is another case. Was challenging factors were noted by evaluated by Fischer's exact test, where difficulty in visualization seen in 8 out of 12 cases, difficulty in visualization in all steps of VR during p-value was really significant. Difficulty in vitreous base section noted in 6 out of 12 cases, p-value was statistically significant, and looking up to the ODA, it was really impossible job in this case, in this eyes. Intraoperative recurrent hypotony was noted with choroidal deformation in one case, but due to leakage around the cannula, as the patient was of ocular cissar tissue pemphigoid patient, and intraoperative bleed was noted only one case, where during membranectomy we faced torrential bleeding around the vascular RPM. We did liberal cautery to prevent the hemorrhage. Postoperative chronic hypotony noted in 6 out of 12 cases. People was less than what was statistically significant. So like the permanent Capro as essential value for visual restoration in patients with corneal blindness, many studies shows that both partial vitrectomy with Capro, it is also a good option. We have intervened 12 times in 10 eyes with vitreoretinal complications after 102 successful cases of permanent Capro 1. In our study, most common indications were retinal detachment, 4 cases, persistent hypotony, and followed by retroprosthetic membrane. We evaluated challenging factors, and the statistical challenging factors were difficulty in visualization, difficulty in vitreous base excision, and postoperative chronic hypotony. Other factors were not significant. So we can conclude eyes with permanent Capro 1 offer challenges for the vitreoretinal surgeons, and these vitreoretinal challenges can be managed successfully. Significant challenging factors identified in our study are difficult in visualization, difficult in vitreous base excision, and postoperative chronic hypotony. Thank you.
Out of the 12 cases you operated,
pardon?
Out of the 12 cases you operated, isn't it?
12 interventions in 10 eyes.
12 interventions in 10 eyes, right?
Yes.
And 6 of them had vitreous hemorrhage immediately after your surgery, right?
Pardon?
6 of them had vitreous hemorrhage, no? After surgery, post-op.
6 of them, no?
No.
Post-op vitreous hemorrhage.
Only hypotony was the main.
Hypotony was persistent. Hypotony was the main post-operative
main
complication.
Post-operative complication.
Challenging.
And was there in how many cases, you said?
6 out of 12. Six out of 12 cases.
Six of the 10 cases had persistent hypotony. And what was
yes.
the visual acuity?
Visual acuity, it varied. It was in a few cases in log mod 1.
Did they have ambulatory vision in spite
log
of
log mod 1, 6 by 60 incidence chart, yes.
In spite of the hypotony?
Yes, yes. Then maintaining the hypotony, but still they are having good vision. This is
out of 102 cases of permanent keratoprosthesis, you said 10 patients had these complications. Now, what was the indication for the primary surgery in these 10 cases which had the problems?
No, I already mentioned in 4 cases retinal detachment, 2 primary retinal detachment recognition, and 1 is hemorrhagic retinal detachment, 1 post vitrectomy retinal detachment. 1 case was epiretinal membrane, 1 case was sterile vitreitis with macular folds, 1 case was was culture negative endophthalmitis.
No.
Yes.
No.
Capro in all cases mainly indication were failed graft where the recurrent penetrating keratoplasty.
You not understood my question.
Yes.
We are running out of time. See, in a large number of patients who have undergone the primary surgery,
yes.
a very small percentage of patients have come back to you. With, so I just wanted to know whether there is any correlation with the primary indication.
No,
there
was no correlation, sir. Yes.
Thank you very much. Now we move on to the next presentation by Dr. Nishikant Borse.
Thank you.
To enhance the potential of BBG stain of ILM by stain pick stain method. Dr. Nishikant, please.
Good afternoon. My paper is based on a very simple observation. We need ILM peeling, which is transparent, and so we have to stain it with Brilliant Peel, which is most commonly used. And most of the times, if we don't visualize the ILM properly, we try to stain it again, and most of the times, the persistent vitreous remnants or ERM, etc., or a poor contrast, they prevent it. Now, what happens if you don't see it well? You can end up traumatizing the retina. You can have a retinal hemorrhage. Commonly, we just do a restaining or a FG with a restaining. Now, this study was basically aimed to know whether we can do a restaining with after picking up the first initial ILM pick. And it is based on a simple observation that the scrolled ILM edge always stains better than intact ILM. So this is a prospective interventional non-comparative clinical series which was done. 20 consecutive patients were stained, 10 underwent pick and stained, and 10 were just underwent a restaining itself. After completing the vitrectomy, the staining was done with BPG, okay? And the evaluation was done by the operating surgeon, but it was a very subjective evaluation. And the ILM staining was known, just graded as whether it was good, faint, or absent. The ease of dissection was not considered because it is due to various other factors than the staining itself. And the patients underwent a complete ophthalmic checkup postoperatively to know if there was any toxicity for restaining it after the initial pick. So when we did the results, we observed that the operating surgeon found that the stain, pick and stain method, all 10 cases, they had a better contrast and the visualization of the ILM was better as compared to the restain, in which they felt it was good in 4 cases and fair in about 6 cases. There was no evidence of any retinal pigment or retinal epithelial or a neofiber defect seen in any of the postoperative visits of the patients. Now, this is just to illustrate how it is. This is a case of retinitis pigmentosa with macular hole. Now, here purposely I have taken a large amount of a pick for demonstration purpose, and then when you just restain that particular area and you wash off the ILM, you can see the scrolled edge showing much better as compared to if you just restain from the other areas of the ILM which was stained. And this is particularly useful either for people who are just learning the macular hole surgery or are the beginners. This technique will be useful for them. Or in complicated cases like this, in which there is a foveal myopic foveoscisis. So observe here that I've just done the first ILM stain with BVG. And unfortunately, hardly any contrast seen. So wherever I could see a bit of a staining, there I have just done the first pick. Okay, and then I restain it. And when the dye gets washed off, you can see the fluttering edge of the ILM very clearly. So it gives you the visualization of the ILM much, much better. And then you can go ahead and do the dissection. Now, because of the myopic nature, the contrast, you lose the ILM in between. Here, again, nothing. Just go ahead and restain it. And again, you will see the fluttering edge of the dissected part of the myopic. Here, you can see the dissected part of the ILM. You can restart from there and go ahead and complete it. So the basic reason is the vitreal side of the ILM has the epiretinal cellular or fibrocellular proliferation or the vitreous remnants compared to the retinal side. There have been studies which have shown that the epiretinal side has as much as 58% of remnants as compared to only 23% of cells seen on the retinal side. So even if you do a transmission electron microscopic examination, it will show that, as in this paper, you can see that the retinal side, which is in slide A, which shows the retinal side, it shows just a bit of undulation and not much cellular proliferation as compared to the vitreal side, which is slide B. And this is the basic reason why the scrolled edge stands better than the vitreal side. So in discussion, basically the cellular and vitreous remnants interfere with the uniform BPG stain. So the peak exposes the more uniform retinal side of the ILM. This gives you more contrast and helps in ILM dissection. However, the limitation of the study was it was very objective in nature. There was no way we could actually quantify the contrast which has been improved. And of course, it can have a surgeon's bias and a very small size of the study itself. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir.
Next, we call upon Dr. Divyansh Mishra to present his work on comparison of standard versus innovative wide field OCT images and assessment of VR interface in PDR. Dr. Divyansh, please.
Yeah. So good afternoon, respected judges. Good afternoon, my dear friends, and good afternoon, my teacher. So today my topic is very important. Comparison of standard versus innovative wide field OCT. So what is this innovative wide field OCT? I would like to thank all my contributors because they were very helpful, and especially my boss. So this was the first case. As you can see, this is a case which is having a membrane over the posterior pole and some traction around the macula and some flat proliferation superior and inferiorly. Being a Novice surgeon, I wanted to understand from where to initiate. So I had ordered an OCT. We had a 12 by 12 mm scan, so in which we can see, yes, probably there is a kind of dissection plane over the macula. Oh, it's a little difficult. I may not manage it. Again, nasally, there is no plane. Inferiorly, it's completely flat. How would I manage this case? This is case number two, a very specific scenario. As you can see, there are some lasers cast superiorly. And most importantly, this was for my teaching my fellows that where laser should not be done. So the green dots, what I have put up, are actually the elevated NVs, which I could see clinically. But I wanted to show my fellows. I was not able to do that. OCT, again, 12 by 12, it's seen till the arcade, not beyond that. Third case, very typical case, as what we can see, it's having an inferior sectoral or a pocket of a detachment probably. I do not know what the reason is, whether it's a detachment, schisis, secondary to what. But the OCT helped me a little bit, showing that there is some kind of thinning temporally. So there may be an inferotemporal vein occlusion, as in the photograph you can see. And there is some elevated vitreous opacity, but it was not extending till the point where I wanted the focus of interest to be. So at this point of time, there were questions that whether we can have a wider scan. Our institute is not good enough to purchase new machines every year. So we thought, why not to do something to enlarge the present length of the scan? So this is what we did. Use a 20 diopter lens in the trial frame and then put it over to the patient and then start focusing. As you can see, the OCT would come up very easily. So you would see a wide angle OCT. How does it work? As in this case, you would see a 20 diopter lens causes the anterior displacement of the nodal point. As you can see, the length of the scan also increases with that. So that was a very simple concept. So we utilized 40 eyes of PDR patients, foveal central 12 by 12 scan using a normal standard versus a 20 diopter lens, using the machine which is with us, that is a DRI Topcon Triton Plus machine, and we utilized the images using image J. The exclusion criteria was media opacities, poor fixation, or a poor quality of image. So this was the first case. As we were discussing, I am not able to see where we are. So the green circle is showing exactly till where we are seeing with the present scan, and the lower one is with the 20 diopter lens. As you can see, the scan length has improved from 12 till 16 mm. So the red line is the point where you can see you are seeing further beyond that. As you can see, it's much more clear. You can see there is a primary membrane above and a secondary membrane preretinal. So I knew, yes, that's a point probably where I need to enter. But where is the point where I should enter? So this is the point. I could see much better in this wider scan, as you can see, nasally. And inferiorly, which we were thinking that it's a very flat scan, but as you can see, again, the detachment is also over there, and there is a secondary membrane over there. This was the case very useful in which I could show them that where exactly the elevated NV is there, so that we should avoid those areas of laser directly over them, inferiorly and again nasally, as you can see. As you can see, this is 1.33 times more the largest scan what we are able to do with this. This case, which was peculiarly or doubtful that whether there is a retinal detachment, actually this wide field OCT is very clearly showing that there are bridging areas over there, which is schisis inferotemporally, secondary to the elevated neovascularization. And as you can see, very good quality of images and the attachment so beautifully seen in such scans, okay? So very good quality scans which we can take, but the limitations are always there, like reflections of the lenses or either probably a lens edge effect. And most importantly, we would not be able to take the fundus photograph and correlate with it. So we did some improvisation. Yes, what is that? So this is a 12 by 12 ideal scan which we have, which extends from this area to this area. But using this 20 diopter, we went to 16 mm, as what you can see in the blue area. Yes, beyond that, with 90 diopter lens, which we have with us always in our OPD, we went till 30 mm. Is it really comparable? Probably yes.
So this is the chart which is showing that people who were emetrophs versus hypermetrophs versus myopes less than and more than 5 diopters. As you can see, improvement was there in most of them or all of them, but it was more in cases of myope. Whether the old OCT would work? Yes, it does work. As you can see, from 9.5 mm, if you have a scan, you can go up till 13 mm of a scan. Future implications. Octa, if you have in function of octa, yes, you can do the widest angle of octa, which is not yet available anywhere in the world. So as you can see right now, this is the scan length which we had, 9 mm. And the maximum which is available in market is a 12 mm. But we have gone till 20 mm. So the take-home message is you can double or quadruple the amount of the field. Any OCT can be utilized. The widest octa can be done. And most importantly, you can do it in a non-midriatic case also. So the conclusion is three E's, that is effective, easy, and economical. Thank you.
Interesting presentation. Actually, in our institute also, we have been doing this for quite some time.
Thank
what
you,
are
sir.
The limitations?
Thank you.
I mean, basically, what are the situations where you find it a little difficult to take the pictures?
See, in our case, like these are the best images, but I tell you that out, because when we do a scan, a raster scan, there would be 12 scans which would be done. Out of those 12 scans, you would get at least 10 or 11 scans which would be of this quality. So there are other slides which
Does peripheral lens changes cause any problems?
So in very, very, in cataract cases, if you are getting a normal OCT, you would get this OCT also. Why it is working in this? Because the volume of the scan in the SS-OCT which we have is much more. So that's why, as you could see in the time domain or the spectral domain OCT, the quality was less, but you could see all the retinal layers.
Yeah, as sir just now tried to ask you, the presentation basically relates to the optics.
Yes, sir.
So was there any specific optical contraindication where you would not use this method?
Please come again with the question whether optical there. As I told you, if we are getting a scan of a normal OCT, you would get this scan.
What about pseudophakic patient?
Yes, yes. So as you could see, the fundus photograph is not seen because the flash, because this works on a flash-based system. If it's a Heidelberg, you would get a pseudo image of a very large area. So we do not have that. So that's why I showed that octa, which we did. We can do a projection image also, but that's not very correlating. So that's why we did octa.
What I wanted to ask was the internal reflections in case of pseudophakic patients.
It does not help, sir. It does not. Means it does not cause any side effects, rather to say. So nothing, if you're getting a normal scan, you would get this. But most important, if the patient has to be little cooperative, because initially what happens, the fixation gets blurred. When we try to focus, the fixation gets blurred. So if the patient is able to fixate just for a more 2 seconds when we are manually changing the focus, so at that point of time, if he's fixating, yes, you would be able to get it. So as you could see, the octa, the whole octa is done. So it takes, in Triton, 9x9, which we have, it takes around 60 seconds. So you could see that there were only some saccade movement which were there in the lower part of the photographs, not in the upper part, as you could see. So as you can see, the lower part is having those saccade movements. So fixation is good enough. So there is no problems in that.
Thank you, Divyansh.
Thank you.
We move on to the next paper by Dr. Upma Awasthi. Please come over. She will be talking to us about retinal imaging techniques as a tool for predicting visual prognosis in diabetic retinopathy. Dr. Upma, please.
Very good afternoon to all. Today, my topic of presentation is retinal imaging techniques as a tool of predicting visual prognosis in diabetic retinopathy. And I'm thankful to IOS for giving me this opportunity and Dr. Ajay for supporting me out. With this next. Oh, sir, it's not working. Yeah. sorry for
just
the interruption.
Reset the timer, please. Reset the timer. Yes,
thank
doctor.
You, sir. Very good afternoon, sir, and thanks for giving me this time. So coming to the diabetic retinopathy, India is actually a hub of diabetic patients, and this number is going to increase to 80 million by 2030. And the diagnosis of diabetic retinopathy is usually clinical, and the imaging tools that are available for the diagnosis are fundus fluorescein angiography, OCT, and the OCT angiography. And these imaging tools help us in planning the treatment, in following up the patients, and for the record and the documentation part. And the treatment available are like metabolic control, that is like hardcore important for any diabetic, and and intravitreals, and the various amount of laser like conventional and the micropulse laser. But increasing multiple injections and increasing laser, that actually increase expenses and also the unrealistic hopes for the patient. And many a times we will end up with an unhappy patient. So what if we can actually, on the prior of the treatment, we can actually predict the visual acuity or the prognosis. So we actually planned this study to find out the role of these imaging tools in predicting visual prognosis. And we have selected the patients who attended our clinic from January 16 to September 16 with the age of more than 40 years, type 2 diabetes mellitus of more than 1 year, and with a patient with clinical diabetic retinopathy, and excluded those patients who were having visually significant cataract and with the other retinal diseases. The all patients underwent detailed ocular examination. In this study, we have used a special software tool for measuring FAS area, which is a COBOS software tool, and it is measured in the pixels. It's a novel technique. And the OCT was done from the OptoView with a raster scan centered at the fovea. And these were the OCT parameters evaluated. These were the outer retinal layer parameters and the disorganized inner retinal layer, that is drill in 1mm and 3mm zone both. The central subfoveal thickness analysis was used as for the OCT analysis, and the central 1mm subfield value was taken as the CFT. And for the measuring of the drill, we have actually marked out the point foveal thickness, which is actually vertical distance between the RP to the ILM at the centered at the scan on centered on the fovea, and the 500 micron on the either side is termed as the 1mm zone, and the 1500 micron on either side of the PFT is termed as the 3mm zone of the fovea. And like in the upper OCT, we can see the PFT was marked as 236 micron. It is measured by the OCT calipers only. And in this upper section, there is a complete normal scan. There is no abnormality in that. And in the lower section, we can see the PFT is 211 micron, but we can find out disorganization and the few hard exits in the lower scan. For measuring the FAS, there is a special tool in which we have actually zoomed in the FFA picture and marked out those capillary. We are given the 12 contiguous points by the software, and when we marked it, the software gives us this value. And the stats were done with the SPSS. We analyzed 25 eyes with a mean age of 59.92 years with a male predominant population. And the mean FAS area ranged from 9610 to 134,517 pixels. OCT parameters were like this. And when we did the analysis, in the univariate analysis, visual acuity was found to be significantly correlating with the drill as well as the FAS. And the FAS area was significantly correlating with the drill in both 1mm and the 3mm zone. But when we run the multivariate analysis, we didn't find none of the factors correlating with the BCVA. Going to the literature, this is a landmark study by Sun et al. Published in JAMA Ophthalmol, in which they have published that every 300 micron increase in drill at 4 months predict 1 line decline at 8 months. Another study published in Diabetes has mentioned if the patient is having edema with drill, even after the resolution of edema, the drill will remain and these eyes will have the poorer vision. And the recently published study in the ophthalmology by Balaratnam et al., they have also measured phase area, but with the OCT angiography, they found only the phase area to be correlating in both analysis with the visual acuity, not the drill. And they also found the moderate positive correlation between phase and the drill. But this can be explained by the fact they have more number of eyes, plus they have a different method of phase area calculation. So what we concluded is a drill in the phase area can serve as a novel parameter to predict visual prognosis. And take home message is this new FFA software tool may help us in delineating MNF areas. And these OCT and FFA can serve as a tool. Thus, patients can be counseled pre-treatment, and none of the OCT parameters of outer retinal layer correlated significantly with BCVA. And thus, it can be explained by the fact in diabetic retinopathy, initially inner layers are basically more effective. And the drill as well as phase area are the important predictors of visual acuity. Thank you.
Thank you, a nice observation. Have you used any other software apart from COA?
Sir, right now, but from, no. Actually, I have seen in a few more FFA, but there was no software like, software available in any other to mark out those areas. So in the COVA, there is a software for marking actually CD ratio.
Yes.
And that there is for the cup and the disc both.
Correct.
So what we have used only for the cup, because we want only one circle that means. So in that case, when we evaluate, that is always in the pixels. That is the only difference, because all other studies are done in the microns and all, but this is in the pixels. So we really don't have the exact value of normal phase area and all. But yes, when we found this, that's why I'm saying 9610 is the minimum phase area that is involved that we have found. And NMF was present in around 70% of patients. But we need future studies to do more analysis for this.
When you looked at the OCT predictors, did you look at other than drill, you looked at the other ellipsoid zone discontinuity?
Yes, sir, the outer layer retina.
Or presence of hard X-ray, the fovea, because it's a multifactorial diabetic retinopathy.
Yes,
you just
sir.
Can't base it only on the drill. So what all other OCT parameters, like presence of hard exudate, did you measure the amount of hard exudate area plaques or outer ellipsoid zone discontinuity in chronic edemas and stuff?
Yes, sir. Outer retinal layer parameters are evaluated, but we, in our study, we didn't find any outer retinal parameter to be effectively correlating with the BCVA. But yes, hard exudate at fovea, exactly at fovea, was significantly correlating it. But they have hardly, there are only few patients with having this feature.
Okay, thank you so much. With this, we'd like to move on the next presentation by Dr. Hardik Jain. Is Dr. Hardik Jain there? Okay, no problem. So, Dr. Rahul Shroff. Yes, please, sir. We invite Dr. Shroff to present his work on vascular changes on OCT angiography and diabetic macular edema following anti-VEGF therapy. Dr. Shroff, please.
At the onset, I'd like to thank EIOS for accepting my paper. DME occurs when there's a high glucose level in the blood, which causes pericyte loss and endothelial cell breakdown. FFA is the current gold standard, but it does not allow separate imaging of the superficial and deep capillary plexus. OCT angiography is a new imaging modality which allows separating of the superficial and deep capillary plexus, and now there is a software which gives you automated quantification of the area total area of capillary non-perfusion in a reliable and reproducible manner. Several evidence-based studies like RISE and RIDE have shown that there is a 6 to 10 letter improvement in vision and 118 to 250 micron reduction in macular thickness at 3 to 4 years of follow-up. However, some other studies, mainly done using FFA, have shown that there's a worsening of macular ischemia after repeated anti-VEGF injections. the main purpose of this study was to evaluate changes in the foveal avascular zone and in the capillary density following intravitreal injections for patients with diabetic macular edema. The primary endpoints were taken as changes in visual acuity, macular thickness, vessel density, perfusion, and foveal avascular zone. This is a retrospective analysis of 8 eyes of 5 patients who were suffering from diabetic macular edema and were treated with anti-VEGF. Patients with severe macular ischemia were excluded from the study. The calculations were made using the ZEISS automated software. No manual marking was done for any of these patients. The vessel density was taken as the percentage of pixels which showed a flow greater than threshold, and perfusion was taken as the total vessel count divided by the total pixel count. And FAZ was the total diameter of the area which was marked by the software as the FAZ. Most of the patients had NPDR. 4 of the eyes also underwent additional intravitreal dexamethasone injection, that means Ozodex, and 2 of the eyes were also additionally treated with some Tenens triamcinolone. This is the graph showing the changes of vision. There is a improvement of visual acuity from baseline for 90 days, but once the effect of the anti-VEGF and the steroid wears out at 6 months, the vision acuity worsens and again improves after repeated injection. Similarly, with the macular thickness, there is an improvement of macular thickness for 3 months. At 6 months, the macular thickness again increases, and again with repeated injections, it again decreases. However, if you see the vessel density, it is not affected by changes in the macular thickness. There is a transient increase in the vessel density at 7 days, but that may be due to the decrease in the cystoid macular edema, which removes the artifact and shows an increase in the vessel density. Otherwise, if you see after 90 days, irrespective of the macular thickness, the vessel density continues to reduce. And out here for 9 months in our study. However, the foveal avascular zone remained completely constant for 90 days. There's no impact of changes in cystoid macular edema on the size of the foveal avascular zone. Similarly, if you see the capillary perfusion after 90 days, there was a gradual progressive worsening of the capillary perfusion. This is a plot which is comparing macular thickness with vessel density 3 months after treatment. Though these two parameters are poorly correlated, you can see that the regression line shows a gradual progressive worsening of the vessel density post-treatment with anti-VEGF. This is a subgroup analysis comparing the two steroids. Here you can see that though triamcinolone injection causes the maximum reduction of macular thickness at 90 days, it also causes the maximum worsening of the vessel density. Comparatively, patients treated with intravitreal dexamethasone have much more stable vessel densities. So in our other studies have also shown that the vessel density increases for 7 days due to the artifact which is created by cystoid macular edema due to the reduction of that artifact. In our study we showed that vessel density after 90 days post treatment continues to worsen, and however the FAZ remains stable in spite of changes in CME. So the limitations of this study are the small sample size, the short follow-up time, and lack of control, and only large clinical trials done comparing anti-VEGF with sham will show whether this is a part of the natural process or it is a impact of the anti-VEGF injections. Thank you.
Rahul, just one or two questions. Number one is, now you had 8 eyes, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a very small sample size, short
okay.
Follow-up.
And,
but
what were the medications you gave?
Yeah, out of the 8, 4 were Ozurdex. I mean, additional to the anti-VEGF.
You should change the title of your presentation because your title of the presentation is Vascular Changes in OCT Angiography Following Anti-VEGF Therapy. Steroid is not anti-VEGF. Steroid is a different molecule.
Yeah, but there are 2 with without steroid also.
No, but then your title of your presentation is Changes After Anti-VEGF Therapy. So you have eyes with steroids, so you should have given it as a different title, Intravitreal Pharmacotherapy.
Yeah.
Following intravitreal pharmacotherapy.
Yeah.
Now you said eyes with severe macular ischemia were excluded. Now what is your definition of severe macular ischemia?
Actually, eyes with very low vision, and on that, on the OCT angiography, if you've shown a very severely enlarged FAZ, I mean, I've not actually measured the size and had a sort of a cutoff point, but if there were large areas of capillary non-perfusion, which you can see very, very clearly, and a very large FAZ, then those I have not included.
Why?
Because actually it'll skew the data a lot. I mean, you'll get meaningless data if you include these kind of studies, because if it's very ischemic, then studies in the past have already shown that further anti-VEGF causes much more worsening in severe ischemia.
No, there is a lot of reports showing that there is reperfusion following anti-VEGF treatment.
Yeah. There are studies showing reperfusion also. There are studies showing worsening also, both types.
Okay.
And all those are done with FFA, but those are not done with OCT angiography.
Okay. Thank you so much, Dr. Stoff. And with this, we move on to the guest talk. On adaptive optics. Can I call upon Dr. Anu Sharma, please? Not there. Huh? Yeah, after that. It will come. So she will be talking to us upon on retinal imaging at microcellular levels using adaptive optics. Meanwhile, when we are fixing the audio-visual glitch, can I request Mrs. Sharma to introduce herself to the audience, please?
Yes, sure, sir.
We don't have your introduction with us, so
yes,
sorry
sure,
for that.
Sir. Sure, sir. Very good afternoon to everybody. I'm Anu Sharma. I'm pursuing my PhD in ophthalmology in Dr. R.P. Center in vitreoretinal services under Professor Atul Kumar, sir.
Okay. Thank you so much for that, and we invite you for your guest talk.
Thank you very much, sir, for giving me the opportunity to speak on the topic, adaptive optics. So, as the name indicates, it incorporates the optics which adapts to the optical aberrations of the optical segments of the eye. Now, we all know there are many high order and low order aberrations in the eye because of the cornea and the lens, such as coma, trefoil, and distortions. So the aberrations not only cause blur image on the retina, but also cause the images of the retina for the camera. So the principle is, again, It improves the lateral resolution with the help of its components. And the lateral resolution is improved to 2 to 3 microns. As we all know, there is an improvement in the axial resolution in the OCTs, especially the SS OCT. So here I'm going to discuss the flood illumination AO retinal camera, that is the RTX1 Image Nice, OSE France. There is one more type of retinal camera which is available, that is based on SLO technology. So this is the view of the retinal camera which we use in our RP center. So there are four components. One is a wavefront sensor, which measures the aberrations. And the next is the correcting elements, which constantly reshapes to correct the aberrations and with the CCD camera and with the computer algorithms, it removes the aberrations to obtain a high resolution retinal images. The optics is depicted here. So the wavelength of the device is 750 nanometer, and there is another source of light at 850 nanometer which illuminates the retina and gives the optical map of area 4x4 degrees of arc. There's a yellow cross in the center for the fixation, and a real-time display with a video camera is present to monitor the fixation. The image acquisition is done with a CCD camera, and it requires a pupillary dilatation with the spherical equivalent error which is being fed in the machine. 40 images are required in 4 seconds, and it can be done at 0, 2, and 4, and even 60 degrees eccentricity along the horizontal and the vertical meridians. The depth can be altered from 80 to 200 microns depending upon the area of interest. The photoreceptors are imaged at 80 microns depth, whereas the retinal vessels are imaged at 200 microns depth. Now coming on to the applications, here the photoreceptor cell density and the spacing with the mosaic regularity is seen in vivo, along with the RPE and retinal vessels. Also, the lamina cribrosa can be seen beautifully with the machine. Now here we are seeing, it will take some time. Okay, it will be seen in the subsequent slides also. Here we are seeing the photoreceptors on the left-hand side and the retinal vessels with the lumen and the wall diameter in the right-hand side. The analysis of the image is done with the computer algorithm along with the deformable mirror. So there is a AO Detect software which processes and gives the density per mm square. So the normative data values have been quite varied in many studies, and still many studies have to be done in Indian population. Now this is the N-fast reflectance image of the photoreceptor. Actually the center of the map is blurred. That is because the very high density of photoreceptor at the fovea. So the machine is not able to resolve, and the density decreases as the eccentricity increases. So these are the Voronoi tessellation of the photoreceptors, where the green are considered to be normal, having the hexagonal structure, and therefore 6 to 7 neighboring cells. So if the geometry of the photoreceptor is altered, the neighboring cell would be less. This is the normal report which we get for the normal individual. I'm going to show few multimodality imaging of few retinal diseases with AO mapping. This is the case of the myopic CNVM, where the CNV has developed in the along the lacquer crack. This is the FFA and ICGA imaging of 45 degree field along with the OCTA, which gives us the 45 degree field. And below is the AO imaging of 4x4 degree arc, where the striations are clearly seen. Here the photoreceptor mosaic is disrupted and it's not normal. There are many hyperreflective areas and hyporeflective areas. This is the case of the neovascular AMD, in which there are a lot of intraretinal fluid. Below is the autofluorescence of the same patient and the OCTA. This is beautifully seen on angioplex Zeiss camera. This is the AO imaging. Again, the ANFAS image is quite blurred with various hyporeflective areas which show the atrophy. On the right hand side are the Voronoi tiles, in which there is just one green colored photoreceptor, and the number of blues and yellows are more. This is the case of crystalline dystrophy. This is the multimodal imaging B scan, OCTA, and this is the AO map, in which the density is reduced from around 30,000 cells per mm square to 20 in the right and in the OD, and around 70,000 in the left eye. This is the case of the cone dystrophy, in which the amplitude has reduced and latency has increased in the MFERG, and the AO mapping, which clearly shows abnormal photoreceptor geometry, and reflectance is also altered. There are many hypo and hyperreflective areas with absolutely no visualization of hexagonal cones. Again, this is the Voronoi tessellation. This is a case of multimodal imaging of macular hole. As clearly seen, there's a lot of loss of photoreceptors right at the macular hole. And this is a post-op 1 month imaging of the same patient, where we are seeing the rearrangement of the photoreceptors. This is the case of the multimodality imaging of toxoplasmosis. And here is the AO mapping done. The left hand side is the margin of the toxo scar, and the center is the central scar is depicted in the right hand side, where there is again no visualization of hexagon cone structure. Now this is the AO mapping of retinal vessels, where we can see the AO map of the lumen and the wall, which can help in the in understanding of the microvascular changes in diabetic retinopathies and hypertensive retinopathies. The capillary bend can also be beautifully visualized in adaptive optics. Now, should we consider it only as a research tool? It aids in the detection of early signs of the disease, and it provides the new information about pathological changes with degrees disease progression. It can help in the monitoring of treatment efficacy at the cellular level, and benefits various clinical trials by accelerating documentation of the treatments. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the very informative talk, and being a guest lecture, so we can't ask cross questions. Sorry for that. Otherwise, we could have had a fruitful discussion. With this, thank you once again for your kind presentation. We move on to the next presenter, Dr. Vineet Mutha.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thanks. On OCT-guided PDT in polypoidal choroidal vasculopathy, a novel approach.
Respected chairpersons and my dear colleagues, I'll be presenting a novel approach in the treatment of PCV, that is a polypoidal choroidal vasculopathy. We'll be treating it with OCT-guided GLD-measured PDT versus ICGA-guided GLD-measured PDT. Under the chief guidance of Dr. Atul Kumar, there are no financial disclosures and no conflicts of interest. PCV is basically a disease of macula and posterior pole with serosanguinous nodular elevations at the posterior pole. It is mostly unilateral and involves aged persons more than 50 years of age. It is diagnosed basically with ICGA, which is the gold standard for diagnosis, which shows polyps, hypofluorescent halo, and branching vascular network. Other aids in the diagnosis are optical coherence tomography, which shows thumb-like polyps, double layer sign, and OCTA, which shows branching vascular network. OCTA may be inferior to ICGA in diagnosing polyps, but some studies have shown that it is more than 95% sensitivity. It has more than 95% sensitivity in diagnosing branching vascular network, which is equal to or better than ICGA. This is the upper picture shows clinical picture of PCV. The B picture shows OCT thumb-like polyps, and C and D pictures shows polyps on ICGA as well as branching vascular network. This is OCTA picture showing branching vascular network. Treatment of PCV includes photodynamic therapy and anti-VEGF. It's combination or singly. Some studies have shown that anti-VEGFs are better, as in Planet study and laptop study, they have shown that anti-VEGFs are better for treating PCV, while Everest study, which is the landmark study, shows that PCV is better treated with a combination of PDT and ranibizumab. Our primary aim is to compare OCT-guided PDT and ICG-guided reduced fluence PDT. This is a prospective study which was simple linear randomization was used with even numbers treated with OCTA-guided, ICGA-guided PDT and odd numbers treated with OCTA-guided PDT. So diagnosis was considered final when at least two of the three first authors approved the diagnosis of PDT PCV. And they were inclusion criteria was GLD less than 6,000 microns and treatment naive cases. So ICG features I have already told, those were the diagnostic criteria. On SSOCT we analyzed thumb-like polyps, double layer sign, central choroidal thickness, central macular thickness, and height of PED. On OCTA we analyzed BVN basically. All the patients received vertiporfin PDT, which was reduced fluence, and ranibizumab injection monthly for 3 months. So these are some of the patients. Upper picture shows on OCT shows fluid with exudation, and lower picture shows the fluid has resolved, and decrease in size of BVN is shown in the right pictures. Again, the same thing, the BVN size is reduced on OCTA pictures, while the subretinal fluid and double layer sign are decreased in the lower OCT picture. It's not going in, not proceeding. Both the groups were age and gender were not different in both the groups. They were not statistically significant. This was a single center study. The upper two pictures graphs show the improvement in visual acuity, and the lower graph shows the improvement in contrast sensitivity over 3 months. These are the SSOCT features. Central choroidal thickness, central foveal thickness have decreased, but they are not significant. Maximum height of PED decrease was significant in both the groups. SRF decreased in 100% eyes from at baseline to 20% eyes at 3 months, which was statistically significant. Thumb-like polyp regression was significant. Double layer sign decrease was not significant in both the groups. OCT and ICGA features both were not significant at 3 months from baseline in both the groups. Polyp regression was significantly, polyps decreased significantly over 65% and 67% in both the groups. But when compared, both the groups were equal in all the above parameters when compared between them. While from 0 to 3 months, both groups had similar features. Now the only difference in both the groups was lesion area treated, which was significantly less in OCTA guided PDT, because OCTA does not pick up polyps that well. So we could not measure the size with polyps and BVN both. So only BVN basically was measured on OCTA. Adverse reaction, the most common adverse reaction was conjunctival hemorrhage. There were no major adverse events. So PDT can halt PCV but cannot treat it completely. So ICG is invasive, slow, and thus could not be repeated in monthly intervals. And OCT can be repeated in monthly intervals because it is non-invasive, rapid, and has more patient comfort. All visual parameters improved. There was considerable decrease in PED height. Thumb-like polyps regressed. Double layer sign and BVN are more resistant to treatment. They were not reduced significantly at 3rd month. Subretinal fluid resorption was equal again in both the groups, and significant reduction was seen at the 3rd month. Lesion area treated was the most important factor, which was much less in OCT guided PDT group when compared to ICG guided PDT group. There were no major adverse effects, as I told. OCT guided RF PDT is non-inferior to ICG guided RF PDT with more patient comfort and similar efficacy. So our limitations were smaller sample size, lack of blinded observers, and less follow-up duration. This was a single center study. So we recommend a multi-center study with a larger population size. These are the references.
Thank you. Interesting paper. I had a few questions. Number one is, all these patients were treatment-naive patients, or were the patients who had already received anti-VEGF therapy, sir, earlier?
Sir, all patients were treatment-naive. These were not treated earlier, sir.
No, they're
yes
all
sir
treatment.
Yes, sir. That's why we got a smaller
number
sample.
Number two
set
is that, yes, yeah, as per your results, the GLD size in the OCTA group was smaller than the GLD size in the
yes,
ICJ group.
Yes, sir.
Now, it would have been interesting if you had also brought the results to see whether the GLD size in the OCTA group, when measured with the all the patients underwent ICG also, isn't
yes
it?
Sir.
In both the groups.
Yes, sir, both the groups ICG.
So in sir the OCTA group also, it would have been interesting to see whether based on the ICG alone, whether the GLD size was smaller or whether it was coinciding with what you are seeing with the OCTA, because that will be an interesting information.
Okay, sir, but I have shown the GLD on ICG in both the groups. They that decrease was not significant, and the GLD on OCTA was only approximately equal to BVN, because only in 3 cases we saw polyps out of 19 cases, sir. So it is almost equal to BVN. So I have
then
compared.
At the end of 3 months, did you repeat the ICGA?
Yes, sir.
Now, what are the features that you saw in both the groups?
Was sir, polyp regression. Sir, first of all, polyp regression, that was the most significant thing. That
yeah, that's
clear.
No, no, no. I want yeah to know whether the changes in the ICGA noted in the OCTA group was coinciding with the features that we see in the other group.
Yes, sir, that I've shown, that I've shown.
Just
repeat, play that again. Sir, GLD on ICGA and OCTA, both were measured in the baseline on both the measures, sir. On ICG also I measured the GLD, and OCT also we measured the GLD, sir. But GLD I have compared both on the basis of ICGA alone. In both the groups, GLD initially was equivalent, decreased, but not significantly decreased at third month in both the groups, sir. Both the groups we have measured GLD on ICGA.
So
it did not decrease significantly.
Which machine was used in your analysis?
Sir, Spectralis for ICGA was used, sir.
No,
confocal.
OCTA.
OCTA we used Triton, sir. 6 mm scans.
So my question is, which segment did you use for analyzing? Because there are multiple
sir,
segments that
retina
you take. So when you treat these patients every month and every visit, you're going to follow up with OCTA.
Yes,
when the sensitivity to pick up these polyps is low in this disease. So
yes,
how do you say on your treatment follow up which segment did you use for measurement in each of these?
Sir, in all patients we use 2 segmentation lines.
Yeah.
One was at the RP, sir, and one was at the outer retina level, sir.
You know, that my question is, does it come with the that custom that is
it
available?
It comes with
the
custom.
Triton?
We do not set it
yeah
by
we
us.
Because
sir
there could
okay
be a large variability if you use the only the custom print
yes
that
sir
comes actually. Be
yes
because
sir
this is one is it could be missed out. There are
yes
cases
sir
where there are polyp without BVN also.
Yes, sir.
To keep in mind.
Yes, sir.
So that is one fault. Second thing is segmentation that you use if you are measuring only on OCTA could be sometimes false if you are
yes
using a different taken at a different level.
Yes, sir.
Isn't
yes
it
sir. That was the drawback limitation of the study, sir. Yes.
This was a prospective study for 3 months.
Yes, sir.
My question is, did you follow up these patients later on also?
Sir, we are actually expanding this series only, sir. We are taking multiple more patients and with a follow-up duration of 6 months, sir.
So
we are expanding
the
this
number is also increasing now.
Yeah, sir, we have more patients coming. But with the availability of aflibercept at our center, the case selection in this study are relatively less, sir.
And do you find similar results in the in the follow-up of other cases as well?
Yes, sir. We are finding similar, but analysis is not yet done, sir. We are recruiting around 50, 60 patients more, sir. So adding up to a total number as 100, sir, that we are doing already, sir. But again, the study will be a single center study, sir.
No problem, Dr. Vineet. With this, thank you very much for
thank
your
you
good presentation.
Thank
we
you
move on to the next presentation will be by Dr. Shruti Sridharan. She will be talking to us about the outcomes of transpupillary thermotherapy in circumscribed choroidal hemangioma. Dr. Shruti, please.
Good afternoon to one and all present here. Transpupillary thermotherapy in circumscribed choroidal hemangiomas. Circumscribed choroidal hemangiomas patients generally present with diminution of vision, which is due to subretinal fluid, or it is due to serous retinal detachment due to the extradition of the tumor. And most commonly, it is located posterior to the equator. It's also seen in peripapillary area and subfoveal area. And patients, there are a wide variety of treatment of which photodynamic therapy and radiation therapy in form of external beam radiation or plaque therapy and transpupillary thermotherapy is used to treat these cases. Our study was to study the outcome of transpupillary thermotherapy in patients with circumscribed choroidal hemangiomas. Ours was a retrospective interventional case series, which was conducted from January 2011 to December 2015. Patients complaining of diminution of vision, which was attributed to the tumor, and the patients were diagnosed with CCH when included in the study. The diagnosis was made on the clinical characteristics, the ultrasound, OCT, and FFA. Patients who had already undergone prior treatment with TTT or PDT, or patients with pre-existing retinal vasculopathies and with questionable diagnosis were excluded from the study. Age, sex, visual symptoms, and the visual acuity at the initial and the final visit were collected from the medical records. The number of sessions for the resolution of the tumor and the cost of the sessions were also noted. Indirect ophthalmoscopy was used to note the tumor location and its position relative to the fovea and the optic disc. The ultrasound A and B scan was used to note down the tumor dimensions that included the largest horizontal and the vertical diameter, and also the tumor thickness. All the patients were treated with infrared diode laser, which was adapted on the Hackstrae slit lamp biomicroscope, and it was delivered. The laser was delivered through a Mainster lens. This is the photograph of the patient pre and post treatment following TTT. Our results suggested that there were 27 eyes of 27 patients. That is, all patients had were unilateral. And the age group was from 14 years to 75 years and a mean of 41.2 years. Male patients were 3.5 times affected more than females. And the right eye was affected twice as often as the left eye. This shows that 37% of the patients presented to us with the correct diagnosis of choroidal hemangioma, whereas 18.5 patients were most commonly misdiagnosed as melanoma. In our study, the most common location of the tumor was temporal to the disc, which was 9 out of 27 patients, and approximately 50% of the patients presented to us with a vision better than 6x18, and 33% of the patients presented with a vision worse than 6x60. We'll be discussing this table in the next few slides. Our experience suggests that TTT is effective in reducing the tumor thickness and the and resolution of the serous fluid, in aiding the tumor regression, and also in preventing tumor recurrence. Gill et al. Found that 36 of the referred patients were misdiagnosed, whereas Shields et al. Reported that only 29 cases came with the correct diagnosis of choroidal hemangioma. In our study as well, only 37 patients were accurately diagnosed as CCH before referral, whereas the most common misdiagnosis was of a choroidal melanoma. A visual acuity with respect to the location of the tumor, Mashayaki et al. Reported the location of the tumor relative to the fovea had a significant role in the visual outcome. Rishi et al. And Guns et al. Showed that the subfoveal tumors could maintain a vision if the extrafoveal parts were treated with TTT. Gill et al. Did not find any association between the distance of the tumor from the disc and fovea with the visual acuity. Even in our study, we did not find any such association. Among the tumors which were studied in our study, which were involving the fovea, although the visual acuity decreased from 624 to 636 post-TTT, the decline was not statistically significant. Even though statistically non-demonstrated, distance from the fovea or the optic disc was not predictive of poor treatment of the visual acuity. Tumor dimensions versus the visual acuity, tumor dimension and the thickness did not play a role in altering the final visual outcome. Vision was stable or it improved by two or more lines in 57% of the cases in which the diameter was more than 10, opposed to the 73% in whose the diameter was less than 10 mm. The visual acuity was stable or improved by two or more lines in the tumor thickness more than 4 mm in 66%, whereas 72% cases showed that the visual acuity was stable when the tumor thickness was less than 4 mm. Despite the small sample size, the dimensions of the tumor do not seem to alter the final visual outcome. Thus, we cannot refute the possible role of TTT in large tumors. The treatment parameters were median spot size of 1.2 mm, the power of 250 milliwatt, and exposure time of 3 minutes. A mean of 2.7 sessions of TTT per tumor was required in our study group. The cost of TTT per eye per session was approximately 3,700 compared to PDT, which costs approximately 91,000 per session. In a developing country like ours, where the per capita income is approximately 1 lakh per year, the insurance infrastructure is also fragmented, the cost benefit ratio still favors the application of TTT as a treatment modality. Therefore, TTT can be used in cases of large tumors where PDT is contraindicated, and PDT causes resolution of the SRF and the exudation of the tumor, thereby improving the vision. TTT is also a cost-effective treatment, especially in a developing country like ours. Even though the number of sessions required, 2.7, is more than PDT, that is approximately 1.2, the overall cost of the treatment is lesser. Thank you.
Yeah, I have one question.
Yes,
what were your, you said the treatment parameters.
Yes.
What was the treatment endpoint in these cases?
Sir, resolution of the...
No, treatment endpoint. You said the parameters that you mentioned.
Yes, sir.
Was it a whitening of the tumor or graying of the tumor at the end of laser application?
Sir, it was resolution of the SRF, sir.
No, that is on your follow-up. But when you treat the lesion, you expose the laser for 3 minutes. So what was the laser setting and what was for foveal treatment, what was the treatment setting used?
So it was whitening of
Yeah, why I'm using this, because we use now only subthreshold laser, because if you're whitening of the, then you'll definitely have a foveal scarring and vision will drop, because we have stopped using threshold laser burns now. We use a extra macular peripheral test burn to find the threshold, reduce it, and then treat the macula, because your treatment parameters were fixed. So the threshold will vary from one eye to the other, person to person. So if you are looking at a whitening of the macula for tumors, especially with thick tumors, it will be it will be a difficult thing to answer, get a result.
Yeah, Dr. Vikas, come in, please.
I'll chip in. She's just a second year DU student. She's presenting my paper. We never treat the fovea. So fovea is never treated whenever you're treating a choroidal hemangioma, even if it is subfoveal. We look at very, very minimal change of the tumor surface. So it's not even graying. It's hardly visible. And like you said, the treatment parameter changes depends on the amount of SRF that is present, depends upon the location of the tumor, peripapillary, what area you want to treat. The advantage of TTT is that you can use multiple spots, large diameter, and you can treat a larger tumor in one sitting, whereas PDT would require, you would not be able to do that. So we treat every 3 months. So this series did not have any patients, like all PDTs and other lasers we've excluded from this series per se.
Nowadays, why people stop? Because she has mentioned that most of the patients, the location was temporal to the disc. That means it's on the macula. So for that location, we use subthreshold regularly in Arvind now, but then this kind of, we use our PDT for choroidal hemangiomas. TTT we stop using because macular treatment, when we use a subthreshold, we are comfortable. Even that we use much subthreshold, but with a threshold burn.
You don't treat the fovea at all, ever. You don't require to, because subfoveal extension is a very, very small part of the actual tumor. So if you treat the tumor per se, the fluid will resolve. So subfoveal treatment is never done.
Thank you very much, Dr. Shruti. With this, we call upon for Dr. Ashish Jain for the last paper presentation on efficacy of perioperative Ozodex during vitrectomy for epiretinal membrane. Dr. Ashish, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon again. So giving my paper on efficacy of intravitreal 0.7 mg dexamethasone implant combined with vitrectomy in patients with epididymal membrane. Epididymal membrane is a avascular fibroproliferative membrane on the macula, which can be idiopathic and secondary. We chose idiopathic ERM for our case series. Simple traction ERM depending upon the morphology of the macula, and type 1 and type 2 depending upon the histological section where the ERM is located. The pathophysiology of ERM, surface breaks formed in the ILM by PVD that allows glial and other cells from the underlying retina to migrate to the defect and proliferate on the ILM. Remnants of the cortical vitreous on the premacular ILM that serves as a structural component and provides a medium upon which the glial and other hyalocytes can proliferate to form an ERM. An anomalous PVD occurs when the extent of vitreous liquefaction exceeds the degree of weakening of vitreoretinal adhesion and leads to posterior vitrocytosis. The proteomics of ERM has shown that inflammatory mediators, growth factors, and cytokines, especially the nerve growth fibers and TGF-alpha, have been involved in the ERM. Macular edema in ERM, pathological pre-existing edema due to the ERM may be slow to clear, persist, or even worsen following the trauma of mechanical membrane peeling. More rarely, true post-surgical CME may develop and can worsen the visual outcomes. The conventional treatment of ERM involves observation, ERM peeling, and a combined ERM and ILM peeling. IVTA has been used with ERM, however, the IVTA uses vitreous as a depot for delivery, and it has been seen that it's 6 times faster clearance in a vitrectomized eye as compared to the non-vitrectomized eye, and is known to cause complications. Mechanically induced diffuse retinal thickening may outlast the short-term effects of IVTA on inflammatory cytokines, effects which are further shortened by the more rapid clearance of IVTA in a vitrectomized eye. Therefore, a more potent, long-lasting medication may possibly be able to circumvent these issues, and therefore the need of Ozodex, which is the biodegradable 0.7 mg dexamethasone implant. The aim of this study is to compare the outcomes of fast planar vitrectomy and PP with intravitreal Ozodex in idiopathic ERM. It is a retrospective interventional case control study of consecutive patients of ERM treated by a single surgeon. 41 eyes of ERM were treated with PPV and PPV combined with Ozodex. Vitrectomy was done using the Alcon Constellation system, and peeling was done with the help of a forceps, and Ozodex was implanted at the end of a air fluid exchange through the sclerotomy port. The parameters observed was best corrected visual acuity, the IOP, the CFT with the help of a OCT, and complications decreased in the vision by 2 or more line or IOP greater than 5 mm rise, and follow-up was done at 1 and 3 months. The demographic details show a mean age of 52.6 years and lens status as 11 were phakic and 18 were pseudophakic and 12 had early cataract changes. The BCV was seen to improve in both the groups. However, it was a significant improvement in the group B, that is with Ozodex, which was maintained at the 3 months follow-up as we saw in the 3 months follow-up on the BCVA. On the OCT, the CFT improved in a similar fashion in the 1 month and which was sustained at the 3 months follow-up, giving a significant result in the group B with Ozodex implant. Just giving a few examples of patients with ERM and cystoid spaces, which at 1 month follow-up showed a resolution which was sustained at the 3 months follow-up, and a similar patient with ERM and retinal thickening showed few cystoid spaces, however was resolved at 3 months follow-up. Ozodex has been shown to be safe for a number of underlying conditions like BRVO, diabetic macular edema, and previous studies have found that a previously vitrectomized eye, subsequent injection of Ozodex is not associated with increased risk of adverse event or diminished therapeutic benefits as compared to Ozodex implantation in non-vitrectomized eyes. In a similar study in Retina published in 2017, they had treated a case series with dexamethasone implant for ERM. However, they had not found a significant correlation with the BCVA and CFT at 6 months follow-up. And a similar study also in 2015 by Yonekawa et al. Had compared the dexamethasone with the IVTA arm of the study, and they had found significant effects of Ozodex for ERM. Use of sustained corticosteroid implant may be especially helpful in post-surgical recovery of vitrectomized patient, where the efficacy of conventional intraoperative intravitreal triamcinol injection may be attenuated. In these cases that we report here, the implant can serve as a source of drug not only for the underlying disease, but also to counteract the normal inflammatory and reactive changes after surgery. Hence, Per-operative Ozurdex or dexamethasone implant results in a significant and faster change in macular thickness and visual gain as compared with the vitrectomy alone for patients with epirectal membrane. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ashish, for your presentation. And we are slightly overshoot the time and so like to conclude the session. I'd like to thank all the panelists, the chairman, Coach Enver, for the wonderful session and all the wonderful audience who stayed with us during the post-lunch session. Thank you very much once again.